Good morning to all of our students, faculty, and staff for our chapel service today, and also, of course, your parents, who I hope are watching along with you as we get close to the end of this most interesting school year. For our service today, we are continuing to use a service of prayer and preaching, and the hymn at the end of our service will be number 878, Abide With Me, which is our hymn of the month for the month of May. We'll also sing that next week for our closing chapel. With that, we begin. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Sanctify us in your truth. Your word is truth. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The epistle reading for the seventh Sunday of Easter is from 1 Peter chapters 4 and 5. Peter writes, "Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you, but rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. But let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or as a meddler. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name. For it is time for judgment to begin at the household of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if the righteous is scarcely saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly set in the heavens. Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. Blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it. Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit. Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. We turn now to three of the six chief parts of Martin Luther's Small Catechism, the Ten Commandments, the Apostles' Creed, and the Lord's Prayer. The Ten Commandments: You shall have no other gods. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The Creed: I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, as I mentioned already, and as no doubt you've been keeping track, this is a school year like no other. And these times in which we're living are filled with things that Peter writes about. Many people are filled with anxiety and fear and worry and concern. And especially when all of this started about 2 months ago, a lot of people were wondering and asking questions that started, what if? What if this happens? What if that happens? Well, what if we lose this? What if we lose that? Well, there's been plenty of anxiety, plenty of fear, plenty of worry, plenty of concern and what if questions over these last 2 months. But how do we as Christians respond? Certainly, we have adapted in the ways that we can. We've no longer meet here for chapel on Wednesday mornings, but we still have regular contact with our teachers and even our friends via Zoom meetings and other online contacts. We also still have homework, at least I do believe we do, and we're getting it done from everything that I've heard. So God's blessings to you as you continue on in doing the work that is before you. But how do we as Christians respond not only in adapting and living under the restrictions that have been given to us, but how do we respond to troubling times? How do we respond to fear and worry and concern, or even those what-if questions that certainly enter our minds and exit through our mouths? Last week, we discussed the importance of always being prepared to give reason for the hope that is within us, that encouragement that Peter gave us as he pointed to the promises delivered in holy baptism. And today we see what comes with that baptismal promise. Not only can we point others to our faith and point them to the cross of our Savior Jesus Christ through his word, but we can also point them to him as the one who takes our anxieties upon himself. Peter says, "Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you," that is, lift you up, "casting all your anxieties on him, because he cares for you." We know that our Lord Jesus Christ cares for us. He came into this world to prove it. He went to the cross and walked out of his grave and proved it. He joins us at the font of holy baptism and renews that promise from the altar in holy communion. But not only that, he daily speaks to us through his word, and he promises that he is always present. He promises that he hears us, that he listens to us, and that he also accepts our anxieties, and in his care, he removes them, pointing us to the victory that he has won. But Peter also calls us to be watchful, and he gives us a warning. He says, "Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour." And this is, and certainly has been true, since the time Adam and Eve first fell into sin. Our enemy, the devil, is seeking to release us from our faith. He's trying to point us to this world and its calamities as far more powerful than the God who created, redeemed, and sanctifies it. Of course, the devil speaks only in lies, but many of them can be convincing. Not only that, but he can present himself as a very powerful and dangerous force as he stands against God and tries to stand in the way of God's love. But Peter calls us as believing Christians to resist him, and to know also that we are not alone in this. He says that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by our brothers, all of our fellow believers throughout the world. We have been going through very difficult and strange times, anxiety-causing times, but we have not gone through it alone. We have one another, even in the limited ways that we now understand. But all the more we have God in his word, as he points us to his son who overcame sin, death, and the devil, who in fact stands in between us and that roaring lion who can do nothing against our Lord or any of our Lord's people. At the same time, we look at this and recognize that he, the Savior of this world, is always close through his gifts of word and sacrament, and we remember his promise, even as we sing in our hymn of the month for May, Abide with Me. In this prayer, we speak and sing together in the second verse, I need thy presence every passing hour. What but thy grace can foil the tempter's power? Who like thyself my guide and stay can be, through cloud and sunshine, O abide with me. Amen. And we pray. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the gift of divine peace and of pardon, with all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Christian Church, here and scattered throughout the world, and for the proclamation of the gospel and the calling of all to faith, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who labor, for those whose work is difficult or dangerous, and for all who travel, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the sick and dying, and for all those who care for them, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Finally, for these and for all our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. O King of glory, Lord of hosts, uplifted in triumph far above all heavens, leave us not without consolation, but send us the Spirit of truth, whom you promised from the Father. For you live and reign with him and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Blessed Lord, you have caused all Holy Scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, and take them to heart, that by the patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We pray Martin Luther's morning prayer. I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger. And I pray that you would keep me this day also from sin and every evil, that all my doings and life may please you. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve you. Amen. We sing now our hymn number 878, Abide With Me.